Okay, good afternoon to everyone that is here now. We're coming back from our closed session. We have our council announce anything coming from the closed session to report.
No reportable action out of closed session. Thank you, President Estramer.
Thank you, Council. We'll move right along then to a public comment. This is the time for members of the public to address us on any issue that's not on the agenda this afternoon. I have no requests to address us under this item, but if anyone would like to, just step right on up. I think we have a public mic over here. All right, seeing none, then we'll move right along to approval of the minutes. January 16th.
Second.
Sorry, let me point out, we'll go with both we'll start with just January 16th, just in case. motion and second on January 16th. Those with motions say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Abstentions? Right along, then we'll move to February 6th.
Move we approve.
Second.
Motion and second. Those with motions say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Abstentions? Move right along to the consent calendar. We have no items under the consent calendar. And we're going to move up 9C first before we get on with the 8A discussion to our DWR Environmental Manager's Report. Good afternoon, Carolyn.
Thank you, Director Estramera.
You're welcome.
Thank you for allowing me to go early. We do have a scoping meeting for the environmental document tonight, so I'll be here until about 3, but then if the meeting isn't over, I do need to leave early to get to that meeting. So as an update on the environmental documentation process, we have started our CEQA scoping process. When I was here last month, we had just released the notice of preparation, and we have now started scoping. We've finished with 6 out of 8 public scoping meetings. Tonight we have a meeting in Brentwood, and the week after, on March 2nd, we have a meeting in Reading. The meeting in Reading was not originally scheduled, but we received a number of requests to have a meeting north of the Delta, or north of Sacramento, specifically within Reading, so we did make that meeting happen on March 2nd. So far, we've been receiving a lot of comments. Participation has been really good. We really appreciate everyone's participation in the meetings. And I think just one other quick update for any commenters today. I do want to remind everyone that this meeting, while related to Delta Conveyance, is not a scoping meeting. So any comments made here are not part of the scoping record. So I would really encourage people to submit environmental comments through the CEQA scoping process.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
We'll move right along then to discussion item 8A, Stakeholder Engagement Committee Update.
Okay, I apologize, Natalie couldn't make it today, but in your packet you have the meeting summary from our February 12th meeting. At the meeting, we sought feedback on the intakes presentation and then gave them an introduction on the launch shaft siting analyses that we had done. I thought the discussions have been challenging to date. And I think as we move forward, the conversations are going to allow for a bit more input from the committee in terms of flexibility on siting. So we have a meeting next week where we're going to solicit feedback on the shaft launch siting, and then we'll introduce them to the retrievals and maintenance shafts along each of the alignments in the Central and East Corridor. We did agree to organize a tour to an existing intake. We were thinking maybe Red Bluff so they could get a sense of the scale and operations of one of these large intakes on the Sacramento River. And also the ISI fabrication shop in the Delta where T-screens are made, which is one of the alternatives that we're currently studying. We are also looking into tours for an operating launch shaft where you can go down and see the tunnel boring machine, the operations of the liner installation, and the tunnel spoils conveying out and stockpiling operation. I think the more that we can give them tours of operating facilities, the more that they can get their arms around the nature of what we're talking about at these meetings. So those are some of the things we'll be working on in the next week or two, is trying to get some of those tours scheduled.
Questions? Yes, Stephen.
With the stakeholder engagement meetings, and maybe particularly the last one, do you have a, how many of the committee members were actually there? Is it a pretty good percentage?
Yeah, attendance is excellent. I think we may have had one missing.
Yeah, one or two.
Yeah, the two came late, but were there. So the attendance has been phenomenal. And the interest and engagement, I think, has been across the board. Everyone at the table has been interactive.
If I could just say, from what I've seen, people are really expressing their viewpoints. Not everything we want to hear, but I mean, we do want to hear it all. But not everything is complimentary, obviously. But it's been very productive, and there's just really, as Catherine was saying, it's very active engagement with that.
Any other questions? Carol, you have anything? Anything to add? Okay, we'll move right along then to findings of the Independent Technical Review Committee report.
So I would like to introduce Dan Adams, who is here. He's the president of McMillan Jacobs, which is a, I'll call it a bespoke design-build firm. They specialize in tunneling and other major water resource infrastructure projects. Dan was the facilitator of the Independent Technical Review panel. We assemble these periodically to take deep dives with outside experts on specific topics. In this case, they were tasked with taking a deep dive into some of our early thinking around tunneling drive configurations and some of the design methodologies. The team consisted of international experts in areas of tunnel construction, TBM manufacturing, and tunnel design. Their focus was exclusively on engineering and construction-related issues, not environmental issues. So Dan is here to present the findings of that panel, and then as soon as he's completed and you've had a chance to ask questions, there's a response from the DCA on their findings that I can summarize for you. So with that, I hand it over to Dan.
Thanks, Catherine. I presume you guys have this document? Okay. So, as Catherine said, there was six of us. I was the chair and mainly just facilitated, and we were asked to look into several major topics on the work that had been done to date. The first one was the tunnel drive lengths. Where we came to after 2 days of working together was that drive lengths of up to 15 miles are achievable. There's a bunch of technical reasons for that on this particular project. The first is that the ground conditions are favorable. It's just soft soils. They're underconsolidated. Alluvial deposits is something the industry considers a straightforward tunnel job on. You have average and not high at all water pressure, so that's relative to the depth of the tunnel. The external pressure on the machine and the equipment doing it is not high. The size of the tunnel is a big deal, a 36-plus foot inside diameter. That's a tremendous amount of space relative to traditional tunnels that most folks are familiar with. It provides plenty of space to have flexibility on logistics within the work, and you could set up a maintenance shop and maintain and operate your equipment as it moves along. And the last technical thing that the team all came together on is that in the operation and planning for the tunnel, setting up for one or two smaller diameter maintenance shafts, which allow someone or entity to get into the tunnel bore machine and repair if it's needed, check how it's operating, is all part and parcel to technically being comfortable with 15-mile drives. There's a few other elements that go into the discussion and why we're comfortable with 15 miles drives, and those are what I'd call softer reasons related to, first, the space between permanent facilities. That's a reasonable driver that would set up the 15-mile distance between them. The schedule drivers on the project, the longer the tunnel project, the longer it takes to build, so you kind of want to limit that to a point that's feasible. And the last topic is the cost and managing competition. As the projects get larger and larger, the field of people interested in pursuing them gets smaller, and you want to have at least four or five entities interested. If we put all those, or both those two kind of bundles of ideas together, up to 15 miles is where we get on the achievable, and the overwhelming summary is that the technology exists to do that. What really drives the job for all four of the contractors and the manufacturer of the tunnel boring machine equipment is that this is more of a logistics job than a tunnel job. Logistics got us into alignment review. So part of our effort as a group, we all got into a big white van and we drove each tunnel alignment, both the, what we called the central corridor and the eastern corridor. That was the documents we were looking at. Spent the day, went to each of the proposed shaft sites, kind of got a lay of the land. The big takeaway through that effort before the end of the first day was that this team that we had together considered the central corridor logistically impractical. The consensus on the team from the people that would be responsible for building this is that it's not worth pursuing any further. That's largely due to uncertainty and concern over logistics. Driving both alignments and spending time, again, it's a group of people in a van, pencil checking stuff on a back of an envelope, but the cost of logistics improvements to the central corridor, everyone was considered would probably exceed the cost of the additional tunnel length on the eastern corridor. The logistics with the eastern corridor and why it's favored is a couple key things. The biggest one in the pile there is the proximity to I-5 and the off-ramps and the fact that that provides flexibility in ways to deliver the job, flexibility on logistics, but also far less uncertainty in pricing and planning. There was a couple spots where the folks on the group liked the Eastern Corridor because there's opportunity for rail or barge if it's there, which is another thing that creates certainty in handling all the material that's associated with the project. On the alignment review, we also looked at the vertical alignment, and everyone in the room, this was actually the second day when we had the engineers come in and explain the job a little more. But raising the tunnel diameter was the tunnel itself vertically, one diameter was considered a really good thing to try and shoot for. It's going to reduce that external head or the pressure on the outside of the machine, which makes building the tunnel that much simpler, relatively speaking, on equipment wear and tear and operations. The settlement concern of days of yore doesn't really exist in the modern era. That used to be why tunnels went deeper. And the shallower the tunnel, if you can picture all the material that goes in and out, whether it's the RTM or the spoil coming out or the equipment, every bolt, if you think of it, has to get into that tunnel, the shallower that shaft, the lower total cost and risk on the job. So that was where we got to on the alignment review. If you go to the next slide, the third thing that we were asked about was all about logistics and advanced procurement. There was quite a bit of work done in some of the documents we looked at and listening from the EDM team on segment manufacture, on-site, off-site, that sort of stuff. The overwhelming consensus was to plan for off-site production of the concrete segments, that's the tunnel lining, and put the responsibility for that work with the contractor on both design and construction of those segments. It's part and parcel to how the job's built. And in the planning effort, make sure there is provisions to provide on-site segments or on-site storage because you'd have a tremendous amount of that material that needs to get to the site and then get used whenever it's needed. We looked at the topic of the reusable tunnel material. We did spend quite a bit of energy on this itself because it's a big deal in the tunnel industry for, again, cost and pricing certainty. Historically, what comes out of the back of a tunnel, the RTM in this case, has not been considered a commodity that's useful pretty much anywhere. Across the team, no one could think of a project where they didn't have to pay to remove it. Testing would be required, so there was a lot of interest in reuse on the job site with the tunnel material that comes out the RTM, so the team said, yeah, that could be feasible, but you'd need to do a lot of testing to figure out what criteria is required of it when it comes off of our tunnel or is going to be used. Perhaps a bigger thing that this team was concerned about is a determination for what that reuse might look like or where it could be deposited. Habitat restoration was one of the ones, or berms, you know, loosely defined, were two that came to mind that could be possible, but the overwhelming driver was just work now to figure out where or what it's used for in the future. And lastly, related to that, is establishing whatever criteria is acceptable for this ahead of time so that it gets into the construction contract associated with the work. Last topic on advanced procurement and logistics was related to tunnel safety. There's a bunch of regulations in the state of California that drive tunnel work. So early conversations with Cal OSHA is definitely something you'd want to do. It's a major project with a substantial workload of staff. Each tunnel that's built in the state of California requires a tunnel rescue plan. That's a trained and equipment, people with equipment or contractor with equipment that have training to get into a tunnel and out of it to rescue people if something goes wrong. And a big part of the law states that you have to have a backup team within 30 minutes of your main team. That kind of ties to logistics, but based on the size and extent of these, talking to Cal OSHA and the fire marshals wherever whoever has jurisdiction here is something you do ahead of time to make sure everyone understands the rules. And moving closer to I-5 helps with all that. If you go to the next slide, we were asked to talk about contract delivery and what's most appropriate for this particular project, in our opinion, at the time, based on the current market. And it was consensus with all six people that designed, but this is a job that's set up for design build pretty well. There's three key reasons for that. First is the schedule. We were told that the schedule would be sometime in the 2030s to have it completed. Design build gets you started sooner on construction and allows you to overlap a whole bunch of activities that take long periods of time to do. So you accelerate the schedule compared to traditional delivery. You get early contractor involvement. So each one of the job sites, we'd have little sessions on how you would do it. And the logistics and the plans from each builder were very different. And each had a different reason for risks, what they've experienced before. So go and design build allows the contractor to get in and talk to you guys during the procurement period, which not only reduces the engineering the owner does, because each one will do it differently and start over, but it gives early insight for the DCA on the stuff that people want to do so that you can pave the way, so to speak, and de-risk the job. Last part on the preference for design build was related to shaft size and configuration. The shafts were all considered really large, very, very large, compared to some of the builders would do much smaller ones. There's all kinds of little nuances with that. But considering all the temporary work that's required to get in there, everyone has their own way to do it, and it's all tied to the means and methods and logistics of the actual tunnel. So you wouldn't want to prescribe that going into the contract if you want competition. The last, if you go to slide 6, it's related to contract delivery. We talked about contract sizes. If we're talking 15-mile tunnels, these would be very large jobs. And so there was a bunch of discussion, and you have to understand you had a president of one company and an operations officer of another, so you had the people that are actually bidding these jobs. And there was comfort in the $1.5 to $2 billion construction cost range. And the driver of that is the bonding agencies and bonding capacity. There was a different belief that in that range, with that bonding, there would be four or five entities chasing each one of these. There would be some groups put together that do all of them, some groups that chase one and do the next. And the reason, and so that led to another topic, which is on the contracting, a 9-month lag between them is really good because Team A knows what happened to Team B, and it changes the strategy going forward. And on the topic of size, bonding, and timing, the group recommended that the DCA get going on discussions with bonding agencies when this job gets closer, so the market knows it's coming and there's no resistance. If you go to the last slide, the last thing we were asked to do is take a run through what were stakeholder and community concerns with the prior testimony from the work done previously. And it was a pretty good list. It was a 11 by 7 table with a whole bunch of stuff on it. And we went through all of them as a group, and the big ones are on this slide here, the McComley Aqueduct concern over future work from East Bay Mud, natural gas wells and whether or not it makes this job feasible or infeasible, seismic behavior of a tunnel, dewatering, settlement, lining failure, all of the stuff we went through. They're typical concerns of stakeholders, and all the answers that we had or came up with are very standard in the industry to deal with them, and none of them seemed like they were showstoppers in any way, shape, or form. Pretty typical stuff for the tunnel market. That's the report out from the team. The report was final a couple weeks ago, and if you have any questions, I'm here.
Thank you, Dan. Great report. Questions, Steve? Thank you very much.
Just as a follow-up, we appreciated the insights that came mostly from the construction industry. There are a couple of areas that led to some design evolution for us. Knowing in the industry that they felt comfortable with longer runs, given the configuration of the delta, the longer that you can drive the tunnel before you need a new launch shaft is helpful. So we thought about longer runs than we had previously. And then the logistics issues, certainly we're not dismissing any alignments or have a preference of one over the other. There are a lot of factors that go into weighing one alignment over another, but we did appreciate the insights on some of the logistics challenges in getting to some of these areas and some of the rescue and safety concerns, et cetera. So, you know, thinking through how we might mitigate some of those risks as part of the design process is was helpful. And then one last issue was, you know, the historical experience around the reusability of the tunnel material. And so it's leading to some additional thinking on test programs and validations and maybe some full-scale testing of material along the way just to verify it. We'll be producing a lot of material, and we need to nail the properties of that material and its suitability for a range of different alternatives. We feel confident from the information that we have to date that it will be usable for embankments and other types of structural fill on this project. So very much appreciated the effort.
Thank you. We'll move right along then to the intakes update.
Okay, so Phil Ryan will do a quick update. It's largely excerpts from the SEC meeting that we did on the intakes, but I wanted to have an opportunity to present it to the board. Phil Ryan has 36 years of planning, design, construction experience in water supply and conveyance. He spent 13 years as a global conveyance design technology practice leader for Jacobs. Jacobs likes nice long titles for folks sometimes. Good stuff there. Pile on extra words, that's how important you are. But he's been our newly appointed engineering design manager for the DCA, and he's going to talk a bit about the intake work to date.
Thank you. Bill?
So I'd like to stand up, but sure. I won't have a microphone. Is that acceptable?
I have one over there. You can take that one. It's mobile. You can pull it off.
Yeah.
Talks with his hands.
Yeah.
And I assume it's on?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's just go to the first slide. I'll give you an update on the intakes. Very first thing I'm going to do is quickly give you a quick summary of the NOP. It includes a description of facilities that comprise the proposed project, the intakes being in that list. And then we have these corridors that you've probably seen as you reviewed the NOP. And there's a range of flows for studies. So the intakes analysis is consistent with all the corridors and the full range of the flows being considered for the study. Okay, so the very first thing we're going to talk about is intake siting. The siting study area, we started up in essentially the American River in downtown Sacramento and headed all the way down to Sutter Slough. And the reason for that is the additional flow in the river that comes in at the American River And at Sutter Slough, the river starts to bifurcate a little bit, so the sweeping flows we need past the intakes are consistent in that area because there are no practical, for all practical purposes, no big ins or outs on the river between those two points. So the only sites on the east bank in the end were considered. Now, we looked at the west side, and there are sites there, but the logistics of getting over to the west side to build a facility like these intakes, because it's a lot of work, as you'll see in some of the slides I show you, there's really only a bridge at Freeport, which is pretty small, and then another bridge down at Walnut Grove, also very small. So the development of the intakes would require extensive logistics development in West Sacramento and other places. So the West was determined to be not feasible for intakes feeding the Central and East corridors. Then you can see that 1 to 3 intakes are required depending on the capacity. So at the range, you can see at 3,000 we need one intake. At 7,500 we would need 3. And we've sort of focused a lot of our efforts on the 6,000 as our candidate for examples of drawings and that kind of thing, and that would be 2. So we did a site investigation, and it's important to note on the site investigation, and I've explained this also to the SEC committee, the river in this reach for the purposes of this project has been studied extensively. For the previous project, it was gone over by a wide variety of experts in the field from the agencies and consultants and people working in the intake industry. So that informed our analysis as well. We did completely reevaluate the sites, but there's a lot of information that was already out there that we used. So anyway, as you look at this, obviously the outsides of bends is best. You get the best sweeping velocities and the best sediment control past your intakes on the outsides of bends. The agencies generally want us to be about a mile apart so fish have a chance to rest and get back into their fish thing as they're moving between the different intakes. We want the non-shoaling areas. We don't want to be in a place that sediment accumulates. You don't want to have to dredge and have all this sediment coming into the intake. So you want areas that are free of sediment accumulation. We want adequate length. So you think about it, you might find a great spot on the river to put an intake, but these things are really long. They're like over 1,000 feet long. So you've got to have a place that if it's on too tight of a bend, it sticks out in the middle of the river. And that's a flood hazard then. So we need to find places that have good conditions that are long and straight so that we have negligible effects on flood levels. And then obviously there's a landslide impact. So we got to consider the properties, the proximity to existing development and built environment, you know, legacy delta communities and that kind of thing. We got to think about where we're putting these things on the landslide as well. Now, obviously, we have geotechnical concerns. These are big, you'll see there's big basins in them. So you have to be concerned with the foundations and the permeability of the soils and that kind of things in the areas. Obviously, environmental and habitat disruption. Now, admittedly, at our stage of the work, a lot of the environmental analysis will be done as part of the EIR, but we did at least think about if there was any major like sensitive areas that are conservation areas and that kind of thing. And then access, obviously, as everybody says, this is also going to be almost more of a logistics project than an intake project as well. So the logistics access to these sites for the amount of work we have to do is a big deal. So we went through the whole thing. Like I said, the reach has been exhaustively studied. And lo and behold, we concluded the same sites as the previous project. A lot of people aren't very happy about that, but the fact is there really only are 5 good sites downstream of, you know, if you get through the city and you got to get past Freeport and Sac Regional because of some issues with water quality, all the way down to Sutter Slough. There really are only 5 places that are suitable along the river that have the length, the depth, and all the other things that we require. And so that's a credit to the people who worked on this for the last 12 years. They found the same places we did. And we studied new bathymetry and the whole thing. So anyway, those are the 5 sites there. But we did, like I said, we restudied them with the current land use, the current property lines, the river bathymetry, and again, on the east side, and I mentioned the west side not being feasible. And then we also developed a length and knowing the depth at those sites and a conceptual position to make sure that if we picked this site, we really could put an intake at those locations. And again, I mentioned they're compatible with both corridors. So next one, please. So out of these five, we eliminated one at the top, the red ones, and four. One at the top has got a lot of impacts to, there's a lot of properties up there. It's more of a rural residential area. It's got unfavorable geotechnical conditions in that area. And then we eliminated site four. It's essentially in Hood. So it was a little bit too much of an impact to put that facility there, even though that is a reasonably good site from a river perspective. So out of the three that remain, site three is the best. It's the deepest, it's got the best sweeping features, it's a stable hole in the river, and the intake would be the shortest at that particular spot because it's the deepest. And then between five and two, they're both acceptable. River conditions are probably a little bit better at five, but two is further upstream, so you have less impacts on the total habitat disruption in the river, because they measure things as they go further up the river as far as your impact on some of the habitat for the fish species. So between two and five, it's kind of a toss-up at this point in time, and that'll be evaluated as part of the environmental process. So moving on from siting, we did a whole analysis on intake types. People who don't study this don't realize there's probably 20 or 30 different kinds of intakes that you could have, depending, there's a lot more for really small ones, but in these big ones, it gets down to, there's only a few types. We went through an analysis and we've concluded that an on-bank structure, rather than, those of you who are familiar with the city of Sacramento, you know they have the intake, that's an in-river facility. That facility would be so big for this project that it would have flood impacts. So that's not a good solution for this project. So we've elected to go with the on-bank types, and then there's two types of screen technology that we're looking at. The vertical flat plate screens on the right, that's the Freeport facility, and that has a vertical flat plates. I'll show you a picture in a minute. Well, stay back one. And then the T-screens. Now, the T-screens were eliminated in the original project, but technology has really come around on those, and they're a pretty effective method. And again, that's going to be a thing that's going to be up to environmental analysis to determine if those are acceptable. They result in a much shorter structure. All right, go ahead. So this is a vertical plate screen. The screens are the black things on the bottom there. There's a screen cleaner. It's like a giant toothbrush that keeps them clean, and you put panels above them in these slots so that the water only goes through where the screen is, and then it flows through the structure and out those boxes in the back. Go ahead to the next one. Similarly, it would be a similar structure, except for this T-screen would slide down those slots. And the T-screens rotate, and you can see the green thing on there is a brush, and there's a brush on the inside as well. So one of the advantages to the T-screens is they're a lot cleaner and a lot better for actual operations. But as you can see, this thing sticks out in the river. There's more places for the big bad fish to hide and eat the little fish. So they have a predation issue that is being evaluated as to how significant that might be. But other than that, they're pretty equivalent technologies. And so at this point in time, we're carrying both of them forward. So I think there's something missing. There we go. So this is intake site two as an example. So the yellow is how long a vertical flat plate screen would be. It's about 1,600 feet. This is just the structure, and there's some tapering things on the edge as well. The T screens, you can see they're a little more than half the length. So they're about 950 feet long. So you can see that the impact on the river's edge is quite a bit shorter. And just to put it in perspective, if you've been to the Freeport facility, that's how big the Freeport intake is compared to the one. So it just puts the whole thing in perspective at the size of what we're really talking about here. So this is what a rendering of what a facility would look like, because it's more than just a screen. So the screens are in the front. That'd be the river down on the bottom. They would flow through the box conduits into a sedimentation basin. What's important, I don't know how much people realize how much sand and silt is in this water that's flowing down the river. And what we don't want is that to end up in the 40-mile tunnel. We want to capture that stuff that's going to settle at its source in a location where we can control it. We have the ability to get at it and get it out of the system. If we let it into the tunnel, it's 150 feet down. It's something with access maybe every 5 or 10 or more miles, so it's going to be a much more of a challenge to get that material out of there. So that's why there's a sedimentation basin. There's a flow control structure in the back that allows us to maintain even flow through the screens, and then it drops into the tunnel shaft, and then we have some other areas for processing the sediment. So the, like we said, logistics is a big issue. The modes of transportation available to us are rail, trucking and roads, a barge. For roads, we would force traffic to use I-5. It's pretty close to the intakes. We would avoid using 160, the river road. That's going to be a real challenge it would be a challenge to use it even if there weren't a whole bunch of other people using it, but there's a lot of other people using it. And then we were also looking at possible staging centers up at I-5 for maybe concrete batching or employee parking and that kind of thing, so that we could do that, and then only maybe the employees brought in by bus, or we could do all the deliveries and only run concrete trucks in when we needed them, and maybe that way we can use lower emission vehicles and things like that. And then we could potentially barge to the intakes, and then again, if we were up by I-5, there is rail near I-5. So there's a quick picture here. So the proposed approach, again, is to limit our use of the freeways or highways to I-5 and access the sites. There's an existing interchange at Hood Franklin Road up there at the top, and there's one down here at Twin Cities Road at the bottom. Twin Cities Road is in all likelihood going to be a major work center for other parts of the project. So we're focusing on trying to have the intake traffic not necessarily compete with that. So potentially a new interchange at Lambert Road, and then widening and improving those roads, and then building new patrol roads that are on top of the areas that are already being used as agriculture roads. We may cheat into the, with a little bit into the agriculture, but generally on areas that are already roads. And then be able to access the sites without, other than the couple of spurs out to the freeway, without using roads that the public are currently using. So this is the main plan. We're still considering barging, but it's beginning to look, as we look at this more and more, that barging's probably not going to be feasible for the intakes. So one of the biggest issues, so these intakes have this giant cofferdam around them. That's a sheet piled thing that allows us to work in the river. And pounding those sheet piles in it's like a sheet pile strike every couple of seconds for like 6 months. And that's going to be we recognize that's a major issue. So as you can see, the pile driving up there, if you didn't do anything, is up there under in this list we got from Caltrans of sound, that it's up there near the top if you don't mitigate it. Now, you can put noise reduction around your equipment, but basically you're only going to move the pile driving sound into the area between 80 and 90, so it's still going to be loud. EPA recommends construction sites hold their impact to residents in the 60-ish range. So we got to get this noise down. So go to the next one. So we've done a quick noise analysis, and using the lower, there's things they can do in addition to the shrouds with pile caps and that kind of thing. So using that, you can see that our 50 dBA gets to Clarksburg. So our 60 line is pretty close to our intake. So it doesn't really make it to the highly populated communities, but even within that 60 reach, there are still people living there. So there's other things that are going to have to be done. And what we're looking at, you know, again, maybe more effective shrouds, sound barrier walls at some of those facilities. There's even things you can do at those homes by giving them sound walls at their homes, different windows. We're also looking at ways to potentially eliminate pile driving and do it all with vibratory. But that's going to be the subject to the on-site testing. But if we can do that, we can cut the noise pretty significantly. So that's one of the things we're looking at. So with that, I'm finished, and I'll put this back. Take any questions.
Thank you, Phil. Questions? What's that? Yes, Stephen.
Phil, you said instead of pile driving, you do what?
We would auger them, pre-auger holes, and then vibrate them in.
Okay.
So you still, and then you'd have still to grout the piles. So the advantage of driving is you get that inner. The intimate contact of the soil and the pile, because the whole purpose of coffer dam is to keep water from coming up in your site, in your work site, right? So if you auger them in and you shake them in, well, the water's just going to go in that loose augered material. So if you do that, you do have to grout them, at least to get a seal. But that's the one way. It'll probably extend the schedule, but it may buy you a lot of goodwill. The other thing is we would put a vibrated in shroud out in front of us, because it's the other problem why we haven't looked at augering them in the past, or they did in the other, is because when you do that augering, you make a big mess, right? And you can't do that in the river. So you got to be behind a wall that we would put in first.
What about cost compared to cost?
That's going to cost more. We haven't figured out exactly how much more, and it's going to depend on the geotechnical conditions, but it's definitely... But there's trade-offs, though, because this will allow our schedule to probably move more unimpeded than it might otherwise. We can only work in the river, fish windows, if you will. So we haven't completely evaluated that yet. But that's because this has just recently come up as a mitigation measure.
Okay. I think we were looking at technologies to dampen the driving and saw that we still had a fairly large circle of influence, we started looking at some other ideas. I think when we're finished with that, we'll bring that to the SEC as well and back here.
Because that noise level was really a major concern with the SEC.
Sure.
Yeah, and there's one thing to have 60 decibels in a continuous hum versus, if anyone's lived next to a construction site like that.
Thank you, Phil. We'll move right along to E, the DCA monthly report.
Okay, Graham can speak without his hands, so he's going to sit at the table.
I'm going to try. It's kind of a fun challenge.
Yeah, Graham is our forebay and levee lead for the project, and he's a geologist, hydrogeologist, and has done a lot of work on levees and embankments, dams throughout California, and has done a lot of work in the Delta as well. So... Graham's going to talk to you a little bit about the launch shaft siting work that we've done.
Hi.
Good afternoon.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. So first, we'll just start with a run through of some basics to set the stage for the siting study and evaluations we've been doing. So just to highlight some of the key components first, we've got the tunnel launch shaft, and that is the focus of the siting study we're going to talk about this afternoon. But then also there will be intermediate or midpoint maintenance shafts and retrieval shafts that are also required for the project. The importance of the tunnel launch shaft, though, is that it's really the concentration of all the activities, the majority of the activities at the site, tunnel liner segments feeding into the tunnel through the launch shaft as it's progressing along, getting all of the training gear and everything else down the hole, all goes down the launch shaft. And then all of the RTM is coming out of the launch shaft through the conveyors and being managed at the site and then hauled off to wherever it's going to go. So there's a lot of major activities occurring at the launch shafts that's not necessarily the case at the maintenance or retrieval shafts. Oh, sorry, I didn't realize these were all there. I should have let Claudia do it. All right, so looking at the main activities at the launch shaft, again, so here's a picture, just a graphic of a launch shaft. This is a TBM being lowered into the launch shaft, but just to, again, highlight some of the major activities. All your deliveries, segment liners, stockpiling, RTM coming out, all of your power supply going in, tunnel ventilation systems being operated from the launch shaft to ventilate the tunnel, and then worker access. There will be a lot of site runoff management for that superficial portion of the site because you've got a pretty big superficial footprint. And then emergency access, as Dan was talking about, would typically be through the launch site. So the reusable tunnel material, that's typically, I mean, in this type of alluvial setting, it's going to be comprised of clays and silts and sandy materials. It has kind of a soft or consistency of toothpaste as it's coming out of the ground. There are some soil conditioners that are used in the process to help suspend the material and help it work, you know, workable through the process. It will be wet when it's generated out of the machine and to the surface, so it will require drying, most likely, depending on the methods and means, it may require drying before the material is usable for any other purpose. The material will be sampled in regular intervals through the process as it's collected, as well as the water that may be generated through the process will be sampled and tested for environmental constituents, as well as material properties that would benefit the reuse. Just to the pictures we've got on here, this is a sequence of operations. The top picture being hoppers loading the conveyor. The materials typically moved around the site on conveyors would be pretty common. So that's a hopper dropping it onto the conveyor. And then the picture in the lower left is material moving along the conveyor belt. And then in the lower right is getting deposited with stackers around the site. So,
yep. Just a quick question on the conditioners you'll be using. Are those, would those limit what the reuse of the material could be?
So there's still a lot of evaluation that needs to take place, but the conditioners are typically long chain sugar type materials. So they're you know, depending on, again, the specifics that have yet to be determined, it could vary, but those would be the typical materials. Again, the evaluations we have to perform and we have ongoing will make sure that they're appropriate for whatever uses are defined. So the next slide is exactly to that point. There is some available environmental testing that was done. These were samples that were recreated based on, they were samples collected within the Delta from subsurface conditions within the project area, and then they were blended with some commonly used soil conditioners and analyzed for environmental constituents as well as geotechnical properties, just to determine what, you know, what would be expected from this type of product. You know, some initial observations based on this review, the metals in particular generally resemble background conditions. We do live in a portion of the valley where there are some elevated metals, naturally derived metals. Cadmium appeared slightly elevated in samples that were tested, but really not significantly out of whack with regional levels, and didn't appear to represent a human health or ecological risk. There will be a lot of additional sampling performed as part of future soil testing programs, so that's still forthcoming. It will continue to be tested and evaluated. And then in evaluating potential human health and ecological risks, we'll also be evaluating alternatives to control airborne particulate, you know, because there will be a lot of surface work of this material, and so we have to also consider options to control airborne particulates. In terms of potential beneficial reuse, there's a variety of different opportunities. First and foremost, we would like to reuse the material as part of our construction of the Southern Forebay embankment. There's a lot of material that would be needed for construction of that embankment. And so this is a lot of material that will be derived from the project and appears, based on existing testing, to be suitable for that type of application. Also, other mitigation projects within the Delta could very well use some of this material. An example is the picture on the lower left. That's a typical sort of mitigation project that requires some amount of fill material. Levee maintenance with the reclamation districts in the Delta may also find uses for this material. Again, assuming it is suitable material and it meets the specifications for embankment fill, which we will be vetting out. other Delta restoration projects, land subsidence, road improvements, even commercial uses could potentially be reuses for this material. So precast liners, so again, thinking about what's happening at the launch sites, there will be a lot of RTM that's coming out of the tunnel, but also a lot of materials feeding down the tunnel, including precast liners. So this is a large part of what will be stockpiled at the site and fed down through the launch site. These are typically fabricated at a new or purpose-built precast facility. And then they're locked together. That's a picture of, on the far right, that's a picture of the inside of the tunnel with the assembled liners in place. So here, this is a schematic of a layout for a launch site. This is several hundred acres of space dedicated to the launch shaft facility. There's a couple of different key components to highlight. The segmental liner storage, that's the stockpile to keep the operations running and provide the liners necessary to keep the tunnel operations moving. There's a small set aside area for offices and batch plants and things like that. You've got the actual tunnel launch shaft itself, which is on an elevated pad with a large diameter shaft for entering down and launching the TBM, as well as retrieval of the RTM material as it's coming up out of the ground. And then that RTM is conveyed through a dewatering, or it could be conveyed through a mechanical dewatering system, or alternatively, or in addition to, spread and dried and managed that way to help remove the moisture. All of that is still yet to be determined, but those are potential ways that the material could be managed. A lot of the space would be dedicated to the management of the RTM and stockpiling of the RTM material. We do have highlighted on this graphic a rail access on the very top side of the image. That's a concept that would provide a lot of benefits, and if we do have the opportunity to utilize rail access, we can move a lot of material a lot more efficiently that way. So it would be an advantage.
If you had the rail access, would that decrease your footprint at all?
Decreasing the footprint, I mean, it's certainly possible. It's going to depend on how frequently we're able to offload material, how long we want to store it on site, how frequently we want to offload it, but potentially.
Yeah, I mean, if simultaneously there was a beneficial reuse in the Delta that we could swing it around to, then we could definitely shorten the footprint. It's something that we're thinking about.
Right. So in terms of a concept schedule for the construction of the launch shaft, the first 6 months are really for setting up construction access, clearing the site, initial earthwork, just kind of grading and prepping the site. Launch shaft construction, so that's about from the 6 month point to the 2 year point, so it's a year and a half to get that launch shaft constructed. Then there's some simultaneous operations of getting the conveyor belts in place and assembling the TBM, lowering it down the shaft and assembling it in place before taking off and beginning the tunnel drive at a little over the 2 year mark. So with that context, we're now going to review the siting methodology. This is for the launch sites in particular. And so we have, the handout on the right, or the image on the right, I realize you can't read it. This is something that we're happy to share with you if you'd like to see it after the, afterwards I can provide that as a hard copy. But just to summarize for you, the general criteria we've got at the top: construction considerations, then geologic and geotechnical considerations is the second major factor, property and land use considerations, and then existing infrastructure. So those are the four major criteria that we're evaluating. And then there's a series of sub-criteria listed along a couple of columns over, really highlighting under construction considerations a lot of the logistical issues that feed into siting these launch shafts. There's a number of very important factors that are included there. The importance factor column is the little green bubbles there. Those are a mechanism to weight the rankings for those, and so several of the logistical related items are ranked very high, weighted very high, just because of the significant impact they have on siting potential launch shafts. Then the explanations just define those and provide the numerics associated with all of those different factors, and those are on the far right. again, apologize that you can't read that, but we're happy to provide those afterwards. Yep. So we'll review the siting studies. We'll focus first along the central alignment and potential sites, and then focus on the eastern alignment and potential sites. So bearing in mind the long drive scenarios that were mentioned earlier, we started focusing on potential launch sites. With that in mind, the drives could be shortened by establishing intermediate reception shafts at halfway points or somewhere in between those launch sites. So this really is starting to pin what we think are the likely potential areas for a launch site. On the north, we've got a couple of fixed points. We've got the intakes on the far north and the southern forebay on the far southern end. So we have established what we're calling launch site A, and that's the area that's there to the north in blue. A couple of key characteristics of that area. You know, it's a little bit of a short drive to the south. A little bit of a short drive to the north because we're cut short by Staten Island. We don't want to get in there. There are a lot of logistical challenges in there in terms of feeding a large construction project like a launch site. And so we definitely want to focus on areas that we do have access to and can logistically support this type of operation. It would be a shorter drive to the north at the intakes, but that's a good thing. It would minimize some of the impacts at the intakes. Launch site B is down on Bolden Island. You can see that's bracketed to the north by Staten Island and then to the south by Venice, Mandeville, and Bacon. These are grayed out generally because based on our assessment of existing logistics, they really can't support the type of major construction that needs to take place at these drive shaft locations. We looked at sites that could support multiple modes of transportation, not just roads. So roads as well as, in addition to roads, barge, potential for good barge access or rail access within a reasonable distance to help try and feed an operation like that rather than just relying strictly on roads within this type of constrained area. So those islands in gray are those that really don't offer those types of transportation options and supporting of a big project like this. And then we flagged from the Southern Forebay that we would intend to launch from the Southern Forebay heading north. The benefits of that option is that you would be generating that RTM material down at the Southern Forebay, which would fit well if we were intending to construct the Southern Forebay embankments out of that material. So that does position it well for a potential reuse. So now we'll focus on shaft site A on the central alignment. So this is the site that's up on the northern side. It's up around Twin Cities. You can see in the upper left of that image that would be the intakes that Phil was talking about there along the Sacramento River. We considered all of the criteria, sub-criteria. What you're seeing is a color-coded depiction. The greens are more favorable, yellows intermediate, orange is less favorable. These all rack up and are summed through a numerical process. This is graphically colored, but there's numerics behind it. The final rankings are across the very top of the plot of the table and then depicted graphically on the image to the left. So some of the more favorable sites are those in green. They're really, not surprisingly, concentrated along I-5, and there is a UPRR rail line just on the other side of I-5, which could present some additional logistical benefits. So in addition to those logistical considerations, the foundation conditions as you shift out of the delta heading over towards I-5 improve greatly. So we start to get out of some of those peat deposits and softer, looser materials. So those are some other benefits that help to rank these sites that are further to the east a bit better. You can also see we grade out other large areas in there associated with preserves, McCormick-Williamson Tract, Consumers River Preserve. Those are all not considered for potential drive sites. So then shaft site B, this is focusing on Bolden Island, again, Staten to the north and Venice to the south and other islands that would be very difficult to access for supporting a launch shaft. Rank the sites in the same process that I just described for the north side A. One important point to make here is that the evaluation aggregated all of the sites and all of the evaluations together to create the rankings and develop the bins and categories. And so what you see with Bolden is there's, you know, there's sites somewhere between acceptable and unfavorable, largely because of the difficult foundation conditions and geotechnical conditions. Along the eastern alignment, very similar process to the central, but slightly shifted. We've got, again, starting at the north, the two fixed points of the, well, we've got the intakes on the north and the southern forebay on the south. The launch site A is this time on the southern side of the Consumas River Preserve, taking a bit more advantage of the potential for a long drive, a 10 to 15 mile drive, and that drive zone is identified by the height of that area there. That's the 10 to 15 mile range from the intakes. And then launch site B down, this is on Lower Roberts, down closer to the Stockton Deepwater Ship Channel, just south of Ringe Track, which is also a difficult logistical island to access. But then the same assumption that we talked about on the central alignment, driving from southern forebay to the north so that we're generating that RTM material in the south end for potential reuse. So the factors along, so here we've got shaft site A along the eastern alignment. Now we're south of McCormick Williamson and the Consumnes River Preserve. There are some of the major factors here contributing would be the proximity to good quality roads. So again, some of the logistical factors playing into the ranking on some of these sites. And then shaft site B, this is down along the Stockton Deepwater Ship Channel, just south of the Stockton Deepwater Ship Channel. And there's multiple modes of access here. There's the BNSF rail line running just along the south. That's the east-west line that's running along the picture there. Highway 4 is very close by. And then the Deepwater Ship Channel has the potential for barge access to this area. So again, those logistical factors definitely helping to highlight some of the sites that may have more advantages than others. So that's it for the siting study.
Yeah, and just as a follow-up on that, that's the feedback that we'll be soliciting from the SEC in our meeting next week.
Any questions? Thank you, Grant. Okay, we'll move right along to the General Counsel's report.
President Schmer, did we?
No, sorry.
I apologize. Did we do E?
Sorry, I jumped right over the monthly report.
No, you have it in your pack. If you have any questions,
yes,
I'd be glad to answer.
Thank you. Any questions on that report? First, the CEO report. Okay, the General Counsel's report.
Thanks, President Schmer. I think my report is also in the packet, but I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Move right along to the Treasurer's report. I got a lot of questions.
I am going to follow suit.
But no answers.
No, the report is there. I can answer questions.
Any questions? No answers anyway, so.
No answers.
Okay, we'll move right along to the verbal reports, if any. Okay, and there being none, then we'll. Future agenda items. Okay, no request for future general. Okay, great. So then we'll stand adjourned to our next meeting, which will be March 19th, right here at 2 p.m. It might be a closed session, but we'll publish that if we do.